We're going to please turn your Bibles or your Bible apps over to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. We have 23 to 25, but I'll be reading from 19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way open for us through the curtain that is His body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Please join me in another word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank You once again for this time that You've given to us, that we are able to gather both virtually and physically. We are grateful that You have given us another opportunity to hear and learn from Your word about You, about Your will, about Your ways, all for us, Father. We ask for Your complete guidance through Your Holy Spirit all throughout this evening, Lord God. Please anoint my lips, bless my preparations, and do override anything and everything that as You see fit, Lord God. Let it be You and You alone to speak to Your people. I pray for their hearts and their minds that will be open to Your word, to Your rebuke, to Your love, to Your encouragement. And I pray for those who need to be saved by You, Father. May this be the evening that they will do so. Be with us, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. As I entitled our message tonight, The Freedom of Freedom. The freedom of freedom. It feels good to be released, right? Or, I don't know, if you did see you guys as yourselves as being imprisoned or being, what's that? They call it stay in place order or quarantine in place. It feels like you're being told to stay. It's like being in jail at your own, like a home arrest, right? Or house arrest. It's like being in house arrest. And I say this because human nature, we don't like to be told, right? You don't have to nod your head in agreement. That's okay. But human nature, we don't like being told. Just these past few weeks, I've seen this truth so prevalent, you know, in regards to reopening the church. There's always this attitude that I will not be told what to do. You know, you do an RSVP, that's an issue. You don't do an RSVP, that's still an issue. You can never please anybody. You tell them to come, they're not going to come. You tell them, come, they won't come. So, it's crazy. Human nature is crazy. And all the more, right? All the more we're told to stay home. We don't want to stay home. But the many times that we were told to go to work, we're like, man, I wish I can stay home. Right? Human nature, we don't like to be told what to do. We would rather it to be our decision because we always know what's right, correct? Maybe for some, right? Did you know that for those of us who are from the Philippines, that our motherland celebrated its Independence Day, June 12th. But did you know that that's not the real Independence Day? It was changed. This is a shocker for some of you guys. It was actually July 4, when the United States gave us our independence. But somebody decided to change it. But regardless, we celebrated the Independence Day, June 12. Independence is getting out from something that's hindering you. Freedom is something that you don't have anybody restraining you, right? It's the absence it's the absence of subjection to foreign domination or government. That's the definition of freedom. It's the power of self-determination attributed to the will, the quality of being independent of fate or necessity. Unrestricted use of something. Those are all the definitions of freedom. I entitled it The Freedom of Freedom. The freedom of what? We just read the letter from Hebrews. It's really not a letter. It's really more of a sermon, right? And the author of Hebrews remained anonymous, right? This is the ultimate sign of humility. He didn't need whoever he is. He didn't need to be recognized. He didn't want the jubilation behind it or the celebration behind it or recognition behind it. What was important to him is that he was able to deliver and encourage the Jewish Hebrews, the Jewish Christians that were being persecuted at that time. And he wanted to encourage them. He wanted to encourage them by reminding them of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done from the Old Testament to the cross and the resurrection. The epistle of Hebrews was written to a group of at-risk Jewish Christians and who were tempted to turn away from Christ because of severe persecution. That was the main purpose of it. And the author wanted to emphasize and encourage them with one word, which is better. He wants them to know that what they have in the Lord Jesus Christ is better than what they had in their religious system of Judaism. In Hebrews 10:19-21, the writer summarizes the argument which I read earlier. He has been making since chapter 3 of Hebrews. And if you have time and you're a Christian, you should be reading your Bible. So when you go home, not right now, we'll go to Hebrews 3 and you will read it. The Lord Jesus himself is our great high priest, and he is the perfect atoning sacrifice who was established for us a new and living way to God through his own blood. So the freedom of freedom that we first have as Christians is the freedom from the consequences of our sins. But that freedom didn't come free. That freedom did not come cheap. That freedom cost Jesus his life. That sacrifice to die a criminal's death. Now, if you don't already know, I don't mean to like discourage you, but our faith is under persecution. We are in big persecution. We are under attack. Now we're being told to limit the people to come to church. We were told not to even meet for a certain number of time and days. Yes, there's precautions medically. People can prove it, maybe not. Some people can argue it. People can always argue something, right? But we are under attack. The whole society, our entire culture, is against our faith. If you are going to stand in the Bible, the teachings of the Bible, you will be called close-minded, a bigot. You're stupid for believing stories, fairy tale stories from the past. You're believing an old, outdated book. Everything that is around us is against the Bible. Do you recognize that? If not, just look around you. Start opening your eyes. Step out of your comfort zone. Get out of your house. And you will see that our faith is under persecution. And that's what I want us to somehow discuss tonight. That in the midst of persecution, intense persecution, compared to the actions and the disciples of Jesus, before when Jesus was captured, they all scattered. Right? They all scattered. But when after the resurrection and the Holy Spirit descending, the believers now were encouraged to continue on, to continue to stay in their faith, to continue to believe in Jesus Christ, no matter how tempting it was to go back to their old ways. The Hebrews, the Jewish Christians during their time, were being convinced to go back to Judaism or else. We are being convinced that whatever faith that we have now with Jesus is wrong. You might as well change your mind about it, change your heart about it, because Jesus, your Jesus, is making your life boring. He's telling you to get married first before you have intercourse, right? He's telling you to do certain things like stay in your marriage. Oh, that's boring. Right? It's everything that we believe in, everything that the Bible says, the world is making it, turning it upside down. You know, we were told for many years to not wear our Sunday mask, right? Look at you, what we're doing now. All of you guys are all wearing a mask. The world is doing it. And this is precaution. So we have 3 points this evening in regard. We're going to try to dissect. We're going to try to unpack what we read. There's 3 points. First is to God. Second is to self. Third is to others. So first point is to God. The verse that we're gonna examine is, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. The original word of draw near to means come near, to visit, to worship, to assent to consent, to give permission to come, to draw near. So we're being told to draw near to God. Do you guys know that this is one of the most wonderful things about our God the Father? He is constantly, day in and day out, minute after minute, constantly asking us to come to Him. He is that interested with us. Did you know that? Compare God the Father to your God, your Father here on earth. For some of you who have great fathers, praise God. But there are some who would rather not have anything to do with their children. I provided, leave me alone, let me watch my sports center. Right? I have an illustration here. I remember the first time I met my Lolo, my grandfather. I don't know if you ever met him, Chris. The first time I met him, and before I met him, there's always been these stories, right? There's stories about how great he was. He was his high position in the city, his business there in town. So you're like imagining how great of a guy this dude is, right? It was announced with our family that your Lolo's coming, because he was here in the States. Your Lolo Domingo. So if you were to translate it, my grandfather Sunday. He's coming back. My Lolo's coming back from the States to the Philippines. It was such a big deal, and he was making his rounds because he had 11 children. So he had, you know, it was a pretty many places he had to visit. Then when it was our turn, I saw this man wearing a suit. You know, he was wearing a suit, matching hat. You know, it's like one of those 1920 movies. You know, he removes it. His hair is like pomade, I think. You can smell it. His eyeglasses. And I was like, man, this guy is so cool. This guy is so cool. He looks so smart. I want to spend time with him. I want to talk to him. I want to learn more about him. So we did our cultural thing, the mano. Right? Filipinos know it. You know, mano, you show respect, reverence. Boom, boom. Everybody, Jamie did it. You know, she probably doesn't remember. And then even before I could like ask him how his trip was, or you know, maybe I could show off my breakdancing moves to him because I didn't know any better. he told my mom, tell him to leave me alone because I'm tired. He draws cash from his pocket, hands one to all of us, and then told my mom, tell them to leave me alone because I'm tired. You compare that to God the Father, who constantly says this, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So you go back to Hebrews, right? You go back to Hebrews where it says, draw near to God. Draw near to God. The writer of Hebrews reminds us that the Christian Jews there had, they were feeling that they were unworthy. The Christian Jews, they were probably were so discouraged that the writer of the Hebrews, wanted them to be encouraged and reminded them of Christ's blood that was shed for them. The work that Christ has done for them. And his instruction was to draw near to God. Folks, are you being discouraged with everything that's going on that is against our faith in this society now? Draw near to God. Draw near to him. Because if you're really going to be honest, if you're really in love with the Lord, everything that's happening in the world discourages you, right? Everything that's going around the world right now in our country is discouraging. It breaks our heart. So God is saying, draw near to him. Come to me, Jesus said. Come to me, all of you who are weary and tired, and I will give you rest. Folks, how many of you, I don't know what you're going through, but how many of you spend enough time in prayer with God? The sad thing is we don't spend enough time in prayer if things are going well. Can I hear an amen? That's an honest amen, right? That's the worst thing. That's the irony of the blessings from God. Is when we have it, we forget him. When we're in trouble, we draw near to him, which is good. Which is good. When we're discouraged, we draw near to God. We have to. We should. The reason why we get tired, the reason why we get discouraged for many of us is because we have forgotten to draw near to God. We have drawn to the world. And the enemy is so good, you know. He entices us. He makes us think that it's, come on, this is good. Do this. Take that shot. Go ahead. Take it. It's good. You're going to feel good later. Do have that relationship, even though it's illicit. Go ahead. Do it. You're going to feel better. You're going to be happy. Go ahead. Leave your spouse. He's never going to change. She's never going to change. Go ahead. You'll be happier. But see, we all know that it's not true. Right? For those of us who have done it, we know that it's not true, that it was all a lie. Correct? But we're so easily tempted. We're so easily tempted because we don't draw strength from God. When we don't draw near to God, we don't have the strength to fight the temptation. Always, God's always inviting us to come to him. God, the Bible, it's all over the Bible, to draw near to God, to come to him, to talk to him, to spend time with him. It's always there. Jesus constantly wants us to come to him, to walk by him, to be near him, to draw from him. By doing this, we get strengthened. We have real and true peace. We have the real and true rest that only comes from him. We worry so much about the cares of this world, so much that we forget that we are a new creation in Jesus. It's just like a fish, right? The beautiful fish. The fish can just swim endlessly in water, correct? Because that's what it's created to do. It's created to be in the water and then to be eaten by us, right? But the moment you take it out of its natural habitat, what happens to the fish? It dies. It's the same thing with us Christians, believers of Jesus. The moment you take yourself out, away from God, that you're no longer drawing from him, that you're no longer in the environment that he wants you to be, which is near him, you will be weak. And you will be a prey of this world and the enemy. What can we learn from Jesus as we take his yoke that he carried when he first came here, and again, you know, when he, on his second coming? His yoke is to do his Father's will, to live a life that we were supposed to live, a sinless life, to die a death that we were supposed to have, so we can experience a life with him now, a life with him now and for eternity. Some of us believers, we have this notion that we're only going to enjoy Jesus when we go to heaven. So we make our lives so boring. We think our life here is so boring because everything here is about partying, everything that the Bible says not to do. So we think, oh man, I can't wait to go to heaven because it's so boring to be a Christian. No. You're seeing the world with your worldly eyes. You have to see the world with God's eyes. You know, a new creation, everything changes in you. Your heart changes, your vision changes, your mind changes. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Set your minds on things above where Christ is. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is. Hearts and minds need to be set to Christ and in heaven. And things here will change. The way you see your children, you will see them not as a burden until they're 18, but you're going to see them. You're going to see them as God's gift entrusted to you for a moment. You're going to see your marriage as God's gift to you. Because the Bible says, blessed is he who found a wife. Husband, say amen before you get in trouble. There you go. You're welcome. Get you some points there. Now we have to be grateful for those who are, of us who are healthy. It's been how many months that this coronavirus has been around our lives? And if you are still healthy, praise God for that. You have to be grateful for that. Now, if you don't have your Bentley, who cares? Somebody who has a Bentley and has the coronavirus could care less for his Bentley. Amen? Amen. Somebody's like, no, I want the Bentley. Second point is to self. Second point is to self. Verse 23 reads, let us hold unswervingly to hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. In regards to our salvation, we call that justification too, right? We have no part on that. In regards to our sanctification, we do. We have a part in that. Last week's message in our long and winded resurrection series that we're still not done with, we discussed about the filling of the Holy Spirit. You know, the life, we saw the life of Stephen. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was empowered by the Holy Spirit because he was always drawing near to God. He was always drawing near to God. He loved the Lord and he showed it and he lived it. And we also see, remember in Galatians where Paul said that if we walk by the Spirit, we will not want the cravings of the flesh. We will not want the cravings of the flesh. The word unswervingly or without wavering from the original language is aklinias. I think I butchered that. Aklinias. For it means, it's an adjective, strongly felt and unlikely to change. So you need to be strongly and unlikely to change. If you read that, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess. I was asked by my son, he goes, Dad, how do you know? How do you know that the Bible is what you say? Do you hope that it's real? Or do you know that it's real? You know, you have to give it to my son. He always gives me the hard questions. So I said, Zoe, I know that God is real. I know that God is real because I've experienced him. I felt him in my lowest and in my highest points. My hope, I said, is not, I hope I'm right. My hope is this. My hope is that God will always come to my rescue when I need him. My hope is that when everything is said and done, My hope is that my God will see me and I will see God in heaven. And I told him, my hope, when I use the word hope, it's not the hope where I hope I'm right, so I'm unsure. But I gave him the illustration when I said, if I get a flat tire and I couldn't work it, I'll call you and you'll say I'm on my way. My feelings, there's a hope in my heart that things will be better, my situation will be better because you're coming to my rescue. So that's my hope. My hope is to you, is on you, and for you to keep your promise. It's the same with our God, our hope in God. We have to see it that way. And this is a quote from Rabbi Zacharias. He says here, he tried to differentiate opinion and conviction. An opinion is something you have. A conviction is something that has you. It holds you. It is what motivates you. It is the intelligence in your soul, and you can never change a conviction without changing who you are. It is ultimately your convictions that will drive you through life, especially in the toughest seasons of the soul. So the convictions that a Christian should have is having hope, our hope in Jesus, our conviction that God is true, that God is real. If we go with the world's opinion and you think you're a forward thinker, right? Because you're thinking like the world. If you're going to be thinking of the now, guess what? Tomorrow, you're an old thinker. Because tomorrow, you're no longer new. Do you get it? It's just like the stores in the Philippines. In the Philippines, the sari-sari store, they said, your credit is good, but we need cash. If you really want to borrow money from us, do it tomorrow. That's the sign. Yeah, you come back tomorrow. So you go there tomorrow, the sign still says, come back tomorrow. You'll never get tomorrow. The Philippines, there's no credit score. Everybody's at zero. Who cares about what credit score you have? So conviction on God, our convictions is what drives us. Now, I have a question. Does the truth about God hold you? Do you have that conviction on Him? Do you have that conviction in your heart and your mind that no matter how difficult your circumstances may be, do you have that conviction that you will live for Him? Because you know He's real. Because you know He's true. Because you know He loves you. You know, Rabbi Zacharias died recently of cancer, after serving God for 47 years, 48 years. And he was traveling all over there with the back pain. And in one of his prayers, in one of his teachings, in his testimony, he goes, I prayed to God many times where he said, why not make me healthy? Because I can serve you better that way. I can serve you better that way. That's his prayer. That's his cry to God. But then he remembers, it's not what he needs. It's not what he needs, or it's not even him and his health that will make God work through him. It's God working through him despite his weakness, just like Paul, right? In your weakness, I am strong. When Paul was praying about his pain in his side, thorn on his side. You know, to purify gold, it has to go through fire. Intense fire. The hotter the fire, the better it is. Some people, you know, recently I heard some old Christian, some former Christian, we call him former now, because that's what they wanted to be recognized. This guy who was a gospel singer with a band. And he publicly declared that he is no longer a believer of Christ. He is now an atheist. Maybe there was a argument about the album pay or something. I don't know. But he no longer believes Jesus. He now goes to the other side. The writer of Hebrews reminded the Christian Jews that They have to grab hold of their hope that is in Christ Jesus that they are professing, reminding them of that truth. Because again, the persecution was come back to Judaism, come back to the traditions. Can you see the temple? Where is your temple? Can you see how big our churches are? You know our traditions, it's fun. You grew up doing these traditions. You could at least feel that you're doing something for God. Come back to our tradition. And they were getting discouraged because there's more of those people that are going back to their old faith than them staying with Jesus. And we all feel that, right? There are more unbelievers than believers. And sometimes when you're at work with another believer, they don't act like a believer. And sometimes, unfortunately, that's you. In the break room, right, or at work, they could hardly recognize Jesus in how we speak, the way we speak, and the way we act. And sometimes it makes us wonder, when you get really discouraged, what I have, because this is this what is true? Because I don't think I'm really changing, or I don't see any change in him or in her. But we have to grab hold of the hope that we profess. We have to grab hold of the hope that we profess. You know, do you guys remember? I think it was in 2013 or 2015. There was a shooter in Oregon. A Christian college. The shooter went to a Christian college, Umpqua University. Okay? You guys can Google it. He went there and he started shooting the students there. And his question, because some were just hit on the leg and were not killed, they were just injured. And the difference would be this. His question was, do you believe Jesus as your Lord? And once the student answers yes, he shoots them and kills them on the spot. Go ahead and meet your maker. Next question, next student. If the answer is no, boom, on the leg. So the conviction. I'm giving this illustration because now you think about that situation. What will your answer be? Knowing, let's say you were the fourth guy, right? You're like, man, I think I know what the right answer is. If I want to go back and see my family, I think my answer should be no. But then you deny Jesus, right? So that's an extreme example, but it's true. It really happened. That's an extreme example, but it really happened. Now, you know, we deny Jesus too. We deny our faith too. Not really getting shot, but the way we live. God created us male and female. And now what do we do? When we get attracted to the same sex, we give in. We give in to we have affairs. For those who are not having a happy marriage and they want to be happy, they jump into affairs. Even though that they know that they need to keep their marriage sacred. They made a vow to God, a covenant with God. And they jump into that. You sell God short too. You deny God too by the way you live. Now, if there's such a thing as conviction in your heart that God is real and He's been real to you, you are going to be faced with these things. We are always faced with these things. Hopefully, your answer is correct, right? To our third point, to others. Now we're going to be doing, I still have 10 minutes. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day approaching. You look at the world again. You look at the world, look at our city, look at our country. It's getting worse by the day. Amen? Now, I guess if you are not if your basis of good and bad is already not based on the Bible, then you can argue. But if it's based on the Bible, the truth about the Bible, your qualifier of good and evil, you will agree with us when we say that the days that we're having is getting evil and evil and evil. Now, I say that, and then as we discuss the drawing near to God, as we discuss the conviction of God, the truth about God, and then the writer of the Hebrews says reminds us, let us consider how we may spur one another, encourage one another toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together. Don't you think he's talking about being a part of a church? Don't you think he's talking about staying and being a part of a church and growing in that church, that church body, church membership, corporate worship, and Christian fellowship are primary means through which God's preserving grace sustains true believers. That is how we get encouraged. This is how we get strengthened too, is when we meet together and we are a part of a body and we learn the word together. And then we work towards love and good deeds together. We work on ministries together. You work on your strength. I work on my strength. That is how we grow. That is how we battle in this world that is so discouraging, that is so against God's will. This refutes those who say that the church does not have anything to do with salvation. The fact is that it has everything to do with your salvation. To be saved, it has nothing to do with church, okay? But to continue to grow in your salvation, to grow in your faith, you need church. In 1 Timothy 3:15, Paul says, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. Your faith in the truth of the gospel will not be able to stand without the church in your life. Or as William Willimon puts it, the gospel does not make sense without the church. The gospel does not make sense without the church that makes it make sense. In a church body is where you will be able to exercise the gifts of the Holy Spirit. In the church body is where you will be challenged of your patience, of your love. Because the church is made out of imperfect people, correct? We are all imperfect people with a perfect Savior. That's why you need church to grow. You know, there's, other than the epidemic or the pandemic that we have, the coronavirus, have you guys heard of the morbus sabbaticus? I just laugh. Babe, that's real. It's morbus sabbaticus. You know what? In layman's terms, it's known as Sunday morning sickness. The symptoms are quite interesting of the morbus sabbaticus. It never interferes with the appetite or the effects or affects the eyes. The Sunday newspaper can be read with no pain with this morbus sabbaticus. And watching television seems to help the victim. The only symptom is that you cannot get up and go to church. That's what this epidemic does. You cannot go to church, but you can do everything else. You can change your oil, do laundry, do your yard work, read the newspaper. Strangely, you usually do not feel it on Saturday too. It only happens on Sunday. But it hits when the morning comes, like a hangover. And it never lasts more than 24 hours, because come Monday night football, you're good. But it has a way of striking again next Sunday. After a few weekly attacks, it may become chronic. Yep. I am talking to someone who suffers from morbus sabbaticus. And I stand to tell you, that's an ugly word, morbus sabbaticus. And I stand to tell you that you need to ask the great physician to heal you today, once and for all, from the dreaded disease that cannot strike a death blow to your faith and your walk with Jesus Christ. You know, in Acts 2, 42 to 47, this is the effects to the early Christians in the early church. Because when Jesus resurrected, they all saw him, right, for a long time, for quite some time, and then he ascended into heaven. And then look at this. I discussed this in our prayer meeting. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Acts 2 records the birthday of the church, the early church, when the Holy Spirit descended upon the 120 believers who were assembled in the upper room. It also records the growth process of the infant church. On the day of Pentecost, about 3,000 people believed the gospel, repented of their sins, and were baptized as followers of Jesus Christ. Acts 2:42, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship. They continue to meet together so they can learn about God's word and God's teaching. And then they devoted themselves to prayer. To prayer. Together. You have to have your own personal prayer time in your prayer life. You have to have it, your alone time. But it's also good to have your prayer time with other believers. Because if two or three are gathered in my name, then I will be with them. And the last sentence of Acts 2:47, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Notice that God did not add people to the church without saving them. They have to be saved first. Right? The church does not save you. Jesus saves you. And then when you're saved, you become added. You are added to the church. You have to be added to a church. The organic union of personal salvation and church membership is the unchanging pattern of the New Testament. And throughout church history, wherever biblical Christianity has been practiced, Christians have a high view of the church. I have a few more minutes. Please, I know you're falling asleep right now, but give me a few more minutes. Unfortunately, this is not the case today. People believe that they can be Christians and grow as Christians without being a part of a church. Unfortunately, that's what people believe now. But if you look at the New Testament, the birth of the church, they always had their fellowship. They always met together, and they were excited to do it. I praise God for most of you, for all of you, who wanted to be here on our reopening after many months. And I know that some people wanted to be here, but of course, with their condition, with their health conditions, it's still a very big concern for them to come out and be with other people. And that's fine too. But God knows it, right? We all know this. That when we say, I'm sorry, I can't make it to church, because you know that God knows your because. You can justify your because to someone else, maybe to me. Some people do call in. You know, it's like a calling. They try to call in sick with me, like, hey, pastor, I won't be able to make it. I'm not feeling well. And I'm like, all right, praise God, I'm going to be praying for you. You know, I don't see any point why I should doubt that reason. But for me, our whole point is this. You know, you very well know that God knows the truth. And let it be the truth. That if you couldn't make it for church, because you have a very legitimate reason. And that you always want to be in church with God's people so that you can hear God's word in order for you to grow. There are many today, both unbelievers and professing Christians, who question the necessity and relevance and importance of the local church. Our generation has created a new category that biblical and historical Christianity never conceived, which is called unchurched Christians. Unchurched Christians. They don't need to belong to a church. In contrast, the position of historic Christianity can be summarized in the words of Cyprian, who said, outside the church, there is no salvation. In other words, the biblical answer to the question, who needs the church, is this: whoever wants to be saved. This does not mean that church membership, attendance, and participation can save you. Because not because you're in the garage, you're a car, right? God forgives our sins by grace alone, through faith alone, because of Jesus Christ alone. But God has made the church the stewards of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So a person can be a church member without being a Christian. But I am not sure a person can be a healthy, growing, fruitful Christian without being a participating member of a local church. Christian assembly is a biblical requirement for Christians. It's not legalistic. It's just the way it is. California redwood trees are the tallest and oldest trees in the world. They stand hundreds of feet high, and some of them are said to be over 2,500 years old. Imagine the gray hair on those trees. As a result, you would think that redwoods have tremendous root systems reaching deep down into the earth. But compared to other trees, redwoods do not have many roots, and they do not go very deep. Yet the redwoods have stood for centuries because their roots are intertwined. They're intertwined and interwoven with each other. Against the storms of life that assault our faith in Jesus Christ, we hold each other up. I am encouraged that you guys are here this evening. There have been many Sundays that I have been discouraged, especially that one time when I was preaching by myself and everything was failing. I wanted to cry and smash my phone. If it wasn't live, I would have quit on that spot. We need each other to grow, just like the redwood trees. This is how we stand on the trials that we go through in life. So those of you who have not given your membership to a church, if you're not from around here, or if you're from around here and you've been going to another church, and you have to give your membership to them so that you will grow. So that you will grow. The Apostles' Creed refers to this as the communion of the saints. It is the internal disposition and external demonstration of Christian fellowship that is succinctly summarized in verse 24. Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Living a life of freedom from sin must ignite a personal willingness to live, to worship, to serve, to learn for God. It is not to obtain God's approval. It is because we have been approved by Him through Christ Jesus that gives us the excitement to be with God's people, to learn about God's word, to do good works for Him. It is the result. It must be the result of our relationship with God, our love relationship with Him. Let us be reminded of our need to focus on God and His faithfulness, His love, His grace, His mercy, and His constant invitation to draw near to Him, to come to Him. Let us be reminded of our need to continue to gather so that we can encourage one another. You know, just like this one old guy in the church, in this one person's church, that he could barely hear and he could barely see, but he goes to church faithfully. And one of the young kids went to the old man. He goes, "Sir, can I ask you a sincere question?" And the old man goes, "Have at it. Why do you still come? You can barely hear us. You can barely see us. You don't even get to walk with us." And he goes, "I just want to show you guys whose team I'm on. Whose team I'm on." You know, there's been days, right? There's been days that you're down and you just needed a friend. And they don't need to do anything. They just need to be there with you. For me, those are my children and my wife at times. Sometimes if I'm mad at my wife, it's my children. I'm pretty sure it's the same for her. She'd rather be with my children instead of me. Right? We need those people. We need those people. And you know what? If you belong to a church, that's us. That's the church. Because you see Christ in them, and they should see Christ in you. That is our message tonight. Please join me in a word of prayer as we close. Our Father, we thank you for your message. We thank you for all your truth, your love, your constant invitation to come near you. As we go through this week, Father God, may your Holy Spirit remind all of us all these things that you have given to us today. Father, may you remind us when we face the storms in life, may you remind us of your invitation to come near and to draw near to you, to draw strength from you, to carry your yoke. May you remind us to make our lives for you and about you, and that we may get the peace and the rest that only comes from you, even in the midst of the storm. Knowing that you are with us, Father God, should alone give us peace. May this, Lord God, truth ring true in our hearts and our minds. Forgive us for the times we have failed, Lord God, and taken up the challenges with our own strength, and we try to make sense of it with our own will or our own wisdom. Forgive us, Father. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy that is new every morning. We love you, Father. Help us live for you completely. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And all the Lord's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.